We stopped for the break after pointing out on some specific aspects. The first idea that I wanted to propose to you was the fact that in order to have a proper analysis of an energy conversion system, we have to take into consideration the transport phenomena, transport aspect. And I gave you the example with this Carnot model, and I've shown you in this Carnot model that if we don't take into consideration the finite differences of temperature for heat transfer, then we could obtain one result for the efficiency. And if we really want to take into consideration, let's say, the maximum power that could be possible to be obtained from a specific device, we have to use this endoreversible model. Then I wanted to propose to you as a very important approach to not forget that whenever we are discussing about improvements and studying the processes, the purpose is to make some new ideas, innovation. But in order to make innovation, now we have also a path, a direction. And the direction is to downsize the environmental impact and to make more and more sustainable the systems and devices that we are dealing with. And based on that, I have shown you also that the possible approach should not take into consideration only the operation of the device, like a fuel cell. We have to take into consideration the whole lifetime and a holistic approach to the improvement of the system. And last but not least, I have tried to propose you that in order to develop a holistic approach to fuel cell, we have to take into consideration the coupling between process and structure. So we cannot discuss about proper flow architectures without knowing very well the flow process itself and factors that are influencing this. We could not discuss about architecture of MAE, of the porous structures, of the membrane, without knowing very well the processes that are passing through this. So from that perspective, these were the main ideas that I proposed to you. You may take them or you may throw them. So the main issue is that this is a debate platform where you could come up with also some other possible approaches. Now coming, let's say, straight to the transfer phenomena, I have shown you, let's say, that the transfer phenomena are very, very tiny interlinked, and the couplings between different transfer phenomena are very hidden, and it is quite difficult to isolate those influences. And in that perspective, I have proposed you the grouping into these groups of phenomena, like mass flow, charge flow, and heat flow, in order to start the approach. But I told you that this is not, let's say, the ultimate activity. Actually, in your research, in your PhD activities, you have to go further, passing from these initial steps. So I gave you just the example of gaseous flows, and I have shown you that for the gaseous flows, usually we are dealing with continuum models. All or most of the papers that are dealing with gaseous flows are dealing with the equations based on the continuum model. But I told you that this model has a limitation, and the limitation is coming on the dimension or the scale of the channels. So when we have channels at the order of millimeters, no problem.
We can work with these models, and the results will be very, very close to the expectations. But when the channels are going down to microns, then we have to be attentive. So whatever we are moving from 100 or 60 microns, at that scale, we are approaching this white area where we have to take care of all the implications and the fact that from theoretical point of view, we don't have a coverage for that purpose. Okay, so I told you now that there is this coupling. We are studying the flow process because we want to do take care of the structures, and the structures that are associated to gaseous flows are the bipolar plates. And of course, for the bipolar plates, we have a huge list of functions that have to be fulfilled by the bipolar plates. Starting from, let's say, aspects related to exchange of charges and the electrical junction, aspects related to the reactant gases, and aspects of removing the heat from the process. There are already clear requirements for getting, let's say, appropriate bipolar plates. Requirements which are related to different properties for the bipolar plates, and there are specific already known things about the way in which the architecture of the channels into the bipolar plates have to look like. And in that perspective, you could imagine the word minimization of all transport resistance is the key word. So whenever we are thinking to an architecture, we have to have in our mind the idea of minimization of resistance, and the uniform distribution of reactants into the... You want to explain? Pardon?
What's the meaning of transport resistance? It seems we need to minimize all transport resistance.
So when we say transport, you have seen that we are facing transport of gaseous flows, transport of charges, transport of different other elements. So generically speaking, it's a transport resistance and might be particulated as a flow resistance or a charge resistance or whatever. Okay. So in this perspective, also in the case of bipolar plates, we have to take into account about water management. And yesterday you have seen some hints that have been introduced by Dr. Jorissen regarding the way in which the shape of the channels could allow us to take care of the accumulated droplets of water into the channels. So, based on that, there are a variety of designs, starting with the pin-type flow field, where you have different pins just in order to have the contact, the electric contact, and then among these pins you have any kind of flow options or opportunity. I shall pass quite quick through this because in general I'm sure that most of you are aware about these aspects, the parallel design flow field, the aspects which are important for this, serpentine design, and in the case of serpentine design, you remember that also it was presented yesterday that this is a very good approach to getting, let's say, rid of the condensate. There are novel and innovative type of approaches, and the mind of people is not limited in designing different type of architectures. Here we have a plate on which we have, different mixture of types of directions of flow, just in order to make much more uniform the flow in that. Also, here we have the possibility to have even the coolant on the same plate. So we have the architecture of channels, but also on the same plate we have also channels with the coolant. Of course, when we are developing such an interesting and complex architecture, we have to take.
In this case, what kind of material?
So in this case, it's a steel plate.
Titanium or stainless steel?
Well, stainless steel, basically. And on this stainless steel, it is easier to play with the different type of architectures of channels. But now you have to take care.
Show how to insulate them later.
Yeah, that's the point. That's the major point that could occur, of course. Aspects related to, let's say, seal different type of flows. And much more important is not, let's say, the initial operation of that, but long-time operation of that, where you can have different problems. But as I wanted to say, I mean, the way in which the creativity is evolving is always a trade-off between targeted research. You know something that you have to do and you find a solution for that, and without boundary creativity. I mean, you just sit and say, look, this. And you develop a new architecture, then you discover that it's useless. Okay, I can make another one. And so on. So always creativity, it has been developed based on the mixture or the trade-off between something where they said, look, you have to do that with the following characteristics and has to solve this. And you are thinking, looking, analyzing, and so on, and you're proposing a solution. And there are millions of people, some of them working in the field, but some of them not having any clue with the field. You know that very important breakthroughs in engineering have been done by people that had nothing to do with engineering. I think Michelin was a Pope, isn't it? A priest. Michelin, the one with the tires.
Usually they are left out from high school.
So there were these kind of areas that are coming there, and this makes a fascinating thing. So coming back just to finalize this, a very important, let's say, type of architecture is the interdigitated flow field. It's an interdigitated flow field is very important because it's coupling two scales of flows. So we are talking about the scale of flow at the channel level, and we are talking about the microscale flow through the porosities. And this aspect, by coupling these two aspects, is a very important area. There are many, let's say, solutions for the interdigitated architectures. And of course, here, when we are talking about interdigitated architectures, we are talking by bipolar plates, but also the types of porous materials that are coupled to this. So also there are porosities that are engineered. So there are porosities that are developed in a special manner in order to obtain a special type of flow with this. So usually in order to have a very uniform flow, the idea is to have as many inputs and as many outputs. This is for uniformity. But in order to get rid of the bubbles or of the droplets, you have to find out a solution to have one input and one output. And the trade-off is in between. It's always in between. I mean, all solutions that you will find are mixtures of these two options. And now I'm coming to this two-phase flow, because the two-phase flow is also a very important aspect of flow. From one side, as I mentioned, it is important to take the control of the water content in the cathode side. We shall see immediately that the water availability on one side of the MAP could generate many other problems in the management of the of the cell itself. So from that perspective, it is a very important issue to take the control of the two-phase flow, the way in which the condensate operates and the way in which the droplets occur in the flow field, and the type of the two-phase flow, because according to the complexity and the properties of the materials, of the walls of the channels, we can have different type of two-phase flows that could vary between slug bubble to plug bubble, and could vary from hydrophilic liquid gas flow towards a hydrophobic foam flow. So always in between, depending on the type of the materials, we have different type of...
These capillary forces, right, reproducing in the channel?
There's one side is the capillarity aspects, but there are also aspects of the way in which there are the realized the mixtures between the two phases. And this is very important when you have to design the flow field. If you have an option where the bubbles are much thicker to the walls, you have one type of distribution of the velocities that you have to follow. And if you don't have the accumulation towards the walls, if the bubbles are free into the core of the fluid, there is another situation. So from that perspective, it is important to know how this process of,
the water pressure is not enough, but you're generating water.
We'll come immediately to this subject. The next issue is the water transport.
Yes, before we just
please.
Practically, how one can monitor that kind of
So
theoretically, we can design whatever.
Yes. No.
Practically, how would I know this?
So there are three aspects. The first one is from the design phase, when you are choosing your materials. So you remember the presentation of Dr. Jorissen, when he said that you are starting from a specification, what kind of fuel cell you want. Then you design the processes, and based on those processes, you select the materials. So this is in the design phase when you are selecting the materials, just according to the type of situation that you're going to have. So this is the first. The second one is about the flow architecture. So of course, you will design a structure of channels that is according to what you are thinking that is happening there. But as you said, there are many cases where not what you are thinking is really happening. And this is also quite easy to be solved, because there are now advanced methodologies to investigate and to find out exactly where you have the droplets of water and how this process is going on. This is also in the development phase. So the first one was in the design phase. The second one is in the development phase. The major problem occurs on partial charges when you have the operation of your fuel cell, because it's not operating at the nominal point always. And in that case, you have to develop a sort of approach. There are many references in the literature for developing new algorithms with based on Petri nets, on different other technologies, just in order to have this kind of learning loops. You start from something, you discover something, and then you reshape that, and you come back, and so on. So this is a process of learning.
Can we come out with a kind of troubleshooting strategy? So when you have this, you expect, like, you know, in safety, plant safety, for example, we have a troubleshooting strategy. When you have this, expect this problem and this. When you troubleshoot one, then it goes to the other one, and so on.
For example, we have a system which is
8 kilowatt, but actually it's delivering 4 kilowatt. And it's like a plant, but we don't know what's the problem actually.
So, I want to give you two answers to this. The first answer is, when I was a junior engineer, I was leading a workshop for engine repair. So we were repairing engines for 360 internal combustion engines, 360 kilowatts. And every day we were having on the end of the line 3 to 5 engines ready. Each engine had its own personality. So every day when we were coming to the work and we knew that we shall have engines for tests, we knew that each engine is going to have its own type of problems. And this is, how can I say, a general principle. Besides of the general principle, of course, I mean, there are very clear aspects regarding, let's say, the troubleshooting. Some of them are very basic, like the computation of the quantity of the water that you are generating, and the accordance of the quantity of the water with the flow structure in order to, let's say, evacuate the water. So these are some basic things. I mean, for instance, you have a water generation ratio, but the flow rate is much lower, so the quantity of water that could be evacuated is not enough. Or you are operating at a special point where it's not possible to do that. So these kind of things could be clear, but in most of the cases, it's a problem of art and knowledge. So I remember we had a very old engineer. He was the ultimate weapon that we were deploying. So he was coming with his own hands, putting his hands on the tubes of the injectors, and then he was saying, yes, this has a problem with the crankshaft, but that's it.
There is no prediction for this two-phase. The droplet or bubbles can occur anytime. You cannot predict that.
No, the prediction is possible, as I mentioned. I mean, based on the type of, as I mentioned, the materials that you have, based on the conditions of operation that you know, based on that, you could predict what you can have. But of course, many times, the operation conditions, and you have seen yesterday, in a stack, you can have very different cells. Professor Ali, would you like to say a few words about this aspect of predictability and troubleshooting
things? Difficult to say. If you take the car makers, nobody want the model always the same. But there are some troubleshooting, but you have to calculate the probability of troubleshooting, and you have to decrease probability of troubleshooting. But that's
the air and liquid in the different spectrum of the things, I would say. One is very hydrophilic, the other one is very hydrophobic. If you try to make the material easy going with the other one is not going to work with it. If you do the other way, it's not going to work with it.
Of course. Was why I split it into three phases, the process. So the first one is how to select the materials. This is the beginning in the design phase. Then is the problem of matching the flow field with the process. And the last one is to have the operation conditions accordingly to the conditions that you are facing. Okay,
so really simply is that when we want to make the gas, select the gas flow channel distribution, we need to know how much power we want to get out of this.
We shall have a problem with this. A very simple problem that will be solved together here.
Okay.
And we shall have a hint about this aspect. It's also about, I knew that overnight will work telepathically. So I was saying that the next issue that I propose to you to discuss is about water transport, because as you see, we have water generation into the channels, and from now on the water has to be removed from there, and there are different pathways for removing the water. So first, as I said, the water is produced on the cathode side as a result of the electrochemical reaction, and usually the rate was presented yesterday is proportional with the current of that is passing the cell. But there are several mechanisms of water transport according to the polymer membrane. And you know that before discussing about water transport, we have to discuss about water uptake. Because water uptake is the key element in making functional the membrane itself. So we have different levels of water content. For instance, if you take the Nafion and we introduce it into the water, we shall see that there is a process of diffusion of water molecules into the structure and the membrane, and there are levels of having this diffusion, the introduction of the molecules into the structure. So the uptake has two parts. It was also presented yesterday. Rob, you?
No. Forrest, yeah. Forrest.
Okay, yeah. So Jorissen, Dr. Jorissen, he presented that we have one phase up to, let's say, 65.7 water activity, where there is a mechanism of salvation, and the second step where the water is filling the pores and we have a very steep increase of lambda. And the mechanisms that at present are known and are, let's say, studied in the literature are three, and these are generic mechanisms. So first one is electroosmotic drag, where we have a drag of water based on the activity of the protons, and in this process we have an electroosmotic movement of the water into the membrane. Also, of course, this is proportional with the current, but is depending on a special coefficient, where in the literature is very scattered and how to calculate this, and there are different references for this. The second one is the water diffusion, because here, exactly as your colleague was saying, that you have a water generation, and the more water generated into the cathode side, it will create a potential that will push the water through the membrane. So in this process, of course, this depends on the concentration of water and the gradient of this concentration on the direction of the diffusion. Also, we have here a diffusion coefficient, and we have the hydraulic permeation. We say usually that the membrane should not be permeable and so on, but in reality there is a permeability which is based on the porosity structure of the membrane, and this of course will be dependent on the pressure that is generated or is available on the site of the water generation. Okay, so taking into account this aspect, now we can go to the next class of transport phenomena, and these are mainly related to charge flow. Usually when we are talking about charge flow, we have these two types of charge flow, the proton flow and the electron flow into this structure. And the steps and the levels of this are presented in this view graph. So, of course, when we are talking about the analysis, the phenomenological analysis of the two processes, the ion charge transport is, of course, more difficult than the electron charge transport, because in the case of electron charge transport, we have already the models for electron transport. And we know the mechanism of, passage of electrons for different type of materials. But in the case of ion charge, there are different mechanisms which are overlapping and completing each other. So let's start with the part that is simple. So. Usually for the charge flows in a mixture, the amount of charge flows through a material per unit area, and we have the units for the charge flux as coulomb per square centimeter or amps per square centimeter. Here is coulomb per square centimeter and second, and here is equal with amps per square centimeter. We have Judge flux as minor G and molar flux as capital G, and there is the connection between the two fluxes based on the Faraday constant and the number of charges per carrier. Okay, then of course, in order to have a charge transport, we have to have driving forces, because never we could discuss about a flow without having a driving force for that flow. So usually we have the electric driving force, which is represented by the electrical potential gradient. The second driving force is the chemical potential gradient. And the third one is the mechanical driving force that is represented by pressure gradient. So in the case of electrode, I mean, the voltage gradient is the main driving force for electron charge. In the electron, both a concentration gradient and the voltage gradient is important and has to be taken into consideration. And of course, in the case of charge transport, we shall have always a cost, which means a loss that is associated to that in the cell voltage. And here we have the formula that we are using usually for, let's say, calculating this loss that is a product of current and the resistance of the conductor. So these are leading towards ohmic laws, and we shall discuss further on about the role of these ohmic losses into the entire balance of energy of the fuel cell. So, in the case of charge flow, the geometry is very important in the influencing the resistance. So the resistance is scales with area, of course, this is the first element, then with thickness. The resistance is additive, so whatever resistance you have is increasing the overall resistance, and the dominating resistance is the electrolyte, the ionic resistance. So, yeah, these are some considerations regarding the influence of different scales in the process of charge flow. So resistance scales with area, and usually in order to be comparable, we have to normalize this, and we are using the area specific resistance, ASR, which is calculated with that formula. Scales with thickness, and of course usually we need the shortest path possible in order to have the minimum charge resistance, and in this respect we have to take care of the mechanical integrity, because any kind of cracks into any kind of element or pores or whatever it is could generate additional resistance, non-uniformities, shorting, fuel crossover, contact resistance, and the electric breakdown. So the limit of thickness, of course, this depends on the properties of the materials. The limits of the thickness are the basically by the mechanical integrity. So of course you want to make it thinner and thinner and thinner, but the thickness of that is limited to the mechanical integrity. The thinner you will be less integer from the point of view of mechanical point of view. Non-uniformities, because there are materials, particularly when you have different composite materials and so on, where you cannot cope very well with the uniformities, and shorting, particularly in the electrolyte side. So Yeah, here also some elements. So usually depending on the electrolyte, the practical thickness limit for the current materials vary between 10 microns to 100 microns, depending on the type of material that you are using. And of course, breakthroughs in this area might be always possible. Different types of resistance which are introduced mainly by the connectivities, by the anode, cathode, catalyst layer on both sides and electrolyte. Here some considerations for the ionic resistance. So usually the best electrolytes have this range of ionic conductivities. This has been presented yesterday. And now a few words about ionic conductivity. Of course, when we are talking about ionic conductivity, we have to take care of two major elements. So first of all is how many carriers are available for transporting charge, and the mobility of those carriers. So these are the two elements that are, let's say, supporting the ionic conductivity. And in general, for the polymer electrolytes in the literature, there is an exponential type of law for expressing the ionic transport property. And for a polymer to be a good conductor, it must have fixed charge sites, and it must have also free volume. So, here are some, let's say, considerations about the way in which the polymer membranes are influencing the ionic conduction and the transfer of ions, particularly offering the possibility to proton mobility. Some considerations about Nafion and why Nafion is working such well in this area, offering a very good property for that, very suitable for this purpose.
What's the surface charge of Nafion? Is the Naftan?
Pardon?
Like streaming potential or zeta potential, they are negative, highly negative?
Well, usually when we are talking about Nafion, there are different elements which are introduced for the ion conductivity. But mainly, of course, the potential is playing a significant role to that. Usually, yes. So now coming to the dependence of the conductivity on different factors, here is a plot of the dependence of conductivity on water content, and you could see the higher the water content, the better the conductivity, and almost the same, but with a different slope, is following in the case of temperature. And based on these influences in the literature, it is proposed a relation that is taking care of the water content and of the temperature as an exponential law for the ion conductivity of the membrane. So there are suggested different possible ways for conductivity of these kind of materials. When we have a very low water content, so the hydronium ions are following the special mechanism to further on transport the charges. Then when the water increases, the movement of ions is facilitated. And when we have a highly hydrated membranes, water in interfacial region screens weakly bound water for ion dipole interactions. So,
just can I say a question here? Now, if you're talking about ionic conductivity, basically we are looking at the proton transfer in association with the water transfer.
Well, usually we are talking mainly about proton transfer. But with this, it is associated the water due to the electrosmotic drag.
Yeah, but actually, when we talk, there are some properties related to the material that affect the conductivity. So anyone who develops the material, definitely, if you look at material properties like crystallinity, rigidity of the
you cannot split the two parts.
So they have it also in the unit conductivity, but they are not captured while we, you know, we mathematically express. I'm trying to work on that.
Yeah.
To develop a model that can work out something.
Well, actually, there are some attempts, but most of them are, I have seen in the literature, are empirically. And here, when we are talking about empirically, then there are
using phenomenological models.
Yeah.
With neutron scattering facilities and, you know, all this, they try to, you know, see the role of the structure on the conductivity. Mm-hmm. But normally, we always, you know, like charge with association with.
Of course. So another aspect which is extremely important when we are talking about, let's say, the transport of reactant species is the gas permeation. You know that in principle the membrane should be impermeable to reactant species, but generally speaking, due to this porous structure, we always have a permeation. And the permeation of the membrane is a sort of consequence of the diffusivity properties and the solubility properties of that specific gas. And due to that, we have this formula, and we have also some units for measuring the permeability of the gas. Here there are some results published in the literature about the way in which different gases are following the permeability influenced by the temperature. So we can see here that whenever we have an increase of temperature, there is a tendency of downsizing the permeation aspect. And on the right side, we have the permeation properties in the case of oxygen, taking as a reference water and different types of napion.
But for sure, the hydrogen radiates faster, very much faster.
Of course, you that is clear. Usually, you are losing this always when you have it in the lab for a longer period. So just in order to pass as through a problem solving, for instance, if we talk about the calculation of hydrogen permeability, as I mentioned, this is an important factor that we take into consideration when whenever we are designing different type of systems. The problem is to calculate the permeability in an napion at 25 degrees and 101.3 kilopascal at one atmosphere. So we start from the formula of calculating the diffusivity for the hydrogen at that temperature, 298.15 kelvins. The formula is an exponential one, where we have at the denominator, we have the temperature, and we obtain the value for the diffusivity. Then we calculate the solubility of the napion, and based on this, we are able to deduct the permeability as a product of diffusivity and solubility. Pardon? Okay? And of course, taking into account the molar volume for this specific case, where we are using the universal gas constant, the pressure and temperature, we determine this volume and introduce that in the formula. And also we introduce the ratio for, let's say, converting pascals in centimeters mercuric column, and we obtain at the end, by multiplication, we obtain the value of the permeation. Of course, when we are talking about bearers, it's quite difficult to figure out what this means. So in that respect, the permeation rate is also usually introduced in the sense that we have the permeation rate of a gas that is taking into account the area, the pressure, and the thickness of that membrane. And taking all this into account, we calculate the permeation ratio. So for the problem that it was mentioned, introducing these elements here, we discover that the permeation ratio of that specific gas of hydrogen is 8.5 at 10 minus 7 moles per second. So it is... Yeah, so you could see, and you can discover this always when you are also dealing with experimental works. So this is the reason why permeability is very important, and whenever you are designing a specific type of MAE, don't forget about this specific property. So now this was the first part.
So it's just the first part. But further on, I think we shall have more pleasant discussion. So how long we have until the...
1 hour.
Okay, 1 hour for lunch. So our journey is continuing with the aspects related to the heat and water management, and of course in order to take into account the management of heat and water, we have to start from the energy balance. We have to identify and pinpoint on the heat sources. Continue with some considerations on temperature distribution, and finalize with the conclusions how this has to be carried out. So regarding, let's say, the balance, the energy balance, usually we are starting from larger scale to smaller scale, or to smaller scale to larger scale. So we can discuss about the boundary of the system for the balance at the scale of a stack. And in that respect, it is quite easy because you have a special installation where you know exactly what kind of inflows you have. It's easier the way in which you are measuring this. But further on, it is much more important to study also the problem of a single stack, because of a single cell, because the single cell is getting you much closer to the phenomenology of heat release and heat sinks. So in that perspective, you have to further continue this activity, but taking into account all these constraints. There might be some special setups for dealing with the special, let's say, testing of a single cell. And usually, for such an energy balance, we are measuring or estimating the inflows, the outflows, and of course, the most important aspect that we are interested is to quantify clearly heat and where that heat is. By the way, I would like to put you a question, not because I want to disturb you, but I would like to have your opinion. What is your definition to heat? In the sense, and so what is that physical meaning of it? So when we are talking about heat?
Temperature?
difference. Okay? So, because usually there is a type of common sense that heat is something that you are bringing or you are losing. And it's always a sense of thinking to heat like a lump value, a lump sum value of a quantity of energy. Of course, this is valid, but we should make very clear in our mind that heat is a type of, or a form of energy that exists only, but only while we have a temperature difference. So when we do not have a temperature difference, we cannot talk about heat. This is basic and crucial. But also, there is another problem of scale. Because whenever we are talking about temperature, we have to discuss also about what is the meaning of temperature. What is the meaning of temperature? So the temperature, in the sense that it was introduced in thermodynamics, is based on the concept of equilibrium. So we cannot discuss about temperature if we don't have a system in equilibrium. Otherwise, it's senseless. Then, another important issue, we could discuss about temperatures only applied to macro systems. So to systems with a large number of particles. So we cannot discuss about the temperature of a molecule. Okay? So these are the elements that have to be very clear, because in the analysis of an engine, it's not that difficult. But when we go to a microfuel cell, and where you have scales of microns, and you go further down to nanoscales, then you have a problem. How you define a macro system? How we define a macro system? So it should be a system that has a very large number of particles. So usually when the students are putting to us, the professors, this question, how big has to be the number, we try to hide ourselves next to Avogadro constant. And we say, okay, we are talking about the macro system when the number of particles are close to the Avogadro constant. Well, there is a truth in this, because, the statisticality of a process depends on the number of that. Of course, we can also discuss about different other approaches, but the major and the most important thing that we have to remind is that when we are defining a specific subsystem, we have to take into consideration that should be a large number of particles, and that specific location might be considered as a system which is quasi-equilibrium. Okay? So these are the elements that we have to take into consideration. Once again, heat is always, but always, when we have difference of temperature. No difference of temperature, no heat. We are talking about temperature only when we are talking about macro systems. We are not yet prepared to come down and to solve the problems at nanoscale or picoscale, discussing about heat release, and also temperature is related to the equilibrium, local equilibrium of that system. So if you agree with this, then I'm recalling this view graph. Claude, you also presented this here, this balance, where we have the fuel energy input, and we have the electric energy output, and we can deduct the lump sum, the quantity of heat release as overall from a specific process like this. And in this process, of course, we have to take into consideration the operation conditions of the fuel cell. We can have different operation points, and for these operation points, we can have different values of current and voltage. Please.
Therefore, the energy balance suits concentration of hydrogen and oxygen. So, am I right to assume that nitrogen is in part of the energy balance because some of the fuels are not?
Okay, you always are coming with good questions. So, as far as we are talking about, let's say, the input of energy, nitrogen is neutral. But in a flow, when we have a mixture of gases, the flow, the respective flow, and you have seen yesterday that we never have a so-called dead end situation when all gas is consumed on the anode side. So always we have a stoichiometric ratio which is higher than one. And in that case we have flow. So the nitrogen in that mixture contributes to the transfer of heat to the, let's say, outflow of heat from the point on, from the area where it is released. So from that perspective, it is important to know the concentration of nitrogen, because based on that concentration of nitrogen, we know very well the properties of the air mixture. So based on those properties, we know how to compute, how to calculate that energy content. So, of course, we have to take into consideration the elements that I mentioned, that sometimes we are able to measure only at the stack scale, and then we have to deduct the energy balance for the cell scale, or sometimes we have the elements for the cell scale, but we have to take some assumptions how it should be considered in a scale, in a stack conditions. And from that perspective, we have to take into consideration the number of cells. So in the process of the energy release, it was presented yesterday that the, let's say, energy which is released in a fuel cell is controlled by different losses. And of course, as I mentioned, there are a complexity of different type of losses. But the most generic, the most characteristic losses are the type of activation, and we shall immediately present them, their influences, the activation losses, and of course we are talking about ohmic losses, and we shall see immediately the ratio of each of these. So this here is about efficiency and how we could evaluate the maximum efficiency that we can get from a specific type of fuel. And then we can see how different types of factors are influenced in this process. For instance, in the case of current density, the influence of current density on the heat released by the cell is a type of linear, due to the influence mainly of the resistive type of dissipation. Then the other types of heat sources or sinks are located in the membrane. We have volumetric sources which are caused by the Joule effect. And this is due to the protonic resistance of the electrolyte, and is distributed into the volume of the membrane thickness. The electrical resistance of the gas diffusion layer and of the bipolar plates are many times in the literature neglected, because they have quite a high conductivity, being some carbon-based materials. In the electrodes, we have electrochemical reactions, both on the hydrogen side and on the oxygen side, and we have the activation of a potential. We have also aspects related as heat sinks for water sorption at the membrane interfaces and local sources in the GDL. So just as a view graph, if we want to localize these type of sources, we have to think to distribution like this, as I mentioned, in the gas diffusion layer, in the catalyst layer, and then also in the membrane area. And here are some references from the literature for different components of the heat release. So you can see here we have the Joule effect, which is varying over this black dashed curve. We have the global reaction of vapor water production, which is varying over the blue, and the activations, which are higher and are varying with the current density over the red lined graph. Now, also from the literature, there are presented different types of cells and the contribution of different components of the heat release. You will see that as, let's say, percentage, although they are scattered, but the order of magnitude is almost at the same scale, depending on the type of the measurement. And of course, looking to the percentages, we could see that in the catalyst, the cathode catalyst layer, we have a very high percentage of the heat release, and also the entropic heat, which is located in the area of cathode. So all these are contributing to a view graph which was published by Zhang regarding the way in which the temperature is distributed inside the membrane electrode assembly. There are two sections, AA here and BB, and there are two lines which are presenting the distribution of temperature inside the fuel cell components. So you could see that from the part that is related to the bipolar plate and the channel. So usually here we have a very low level of temperature is the starting point of the curve. Then when we are moving in the area of microporous layer and gas diffusion layer, due to the ohmic heating, we start having a raise of the temperature. Then the amount you can see here is estimated at about 2 watts, just to have an order for comparison. Then we have the anode catalytic layer, where we have two type of mechanism, both ohmic heating but also reacting heating. And then we continue with the membrane. In the membrane, you could see that we have a significant increase of the heat release due to the ohmic heating that was mentioned before. And then is continuing in the cathode catalytic layer, where we have the highest heat release by reaction heating and ohmic heating. Then is continued into the cathode side and is dropping into the bipolar area, into the channels. As orders of magnitude, you can see here the thicknesses of different layers and the conductivities of usual materials that are in different experimental setups.
Excuse me, what's the reference for those
values? So, this reference, Zhang, which was published this year, 2012, is a review paper.
Do we mean 7.1.2.2.1? What is the reference?
So, it was, how can I say, the reference is they took from all reported type of experiments and they estimated as average value what is this. So it was a continuation of the work like this one, like comparing the others, and then they normalized for the same, yeah. So usually speaking, we have, let's say, a graph or a tendency of evolution of temperature inside the fuel cell of this shape. So when we have high currents, so it is clear that at the interface, but closer to the cathode side, we have the highest temperatures, and then the temperatures are dropping down due to the heat transfer realized on both sides of the cell. Okay, now we have this problem and it is solved, and we shall pass just a little bit through it. So it is related to a fuel cell that operates at 0.6 volts and 1 amp per square centimeter, and is requiring to calculate the temperature distribution through a gas diffusion layer bipolar plate sandwich on a cathode side. Okay, so imagine the cathode and imagine this sandwich of GDL and bipolar plate. There are very simplistic assumptions, like assume a constant heat flux at the gas diffusion catalyst layer interface equal to all of the fuel cell losses, except those due to ionic and electrical resistance. Assume that half of the resistive losses apply to the anode side and half to the cathode side. It is not exactly this, but usually if you take into consideration also stack architecture, you may use this assumption. Ionic resistance through the membrane is given in a value of 0.1 ohms per square centimeter. At the outer edge of the bipolar plate, assume that heat is removed by a cooling fluid that is entering at 60 degrees. With a heat transfer coefficient of 1600 watt per square meter in Kelvin, electrical resistivity of the gas diffusion layer and bipolar plate is 0.08 ohms per ohm centimeter and 0.6 respectively. There is a contact resistance of 0.005 between gas diffusion layer and bipolar plate. Effective thermal conductivity of GDL and bipolar plate is 1.7 and 20 watt per meter and Kelvin respectively. There is a thermal contact resistance between these two layers equal to 1 centigrade per watt. Thickness of GDL and bipolar plates are given 0.38 and 3.3 millimeters. So you could see that it's quite a simple didactic problem, just in order to see how to make these assumptions and to use these calculations very quick. So we start from the assumptions. We assume one-dimensional steady state conduction, and then we fix some temperatures. We say T1 to be the temperature at the bipolar plate cooling fluid interface, T2 the temperature of the bipolar plate facing with the gas diffusion layer, T3 the temperature of the gas diffusion layer facing the bipolar plate, and T4 temperature of the gas diffusion layer facing the catalyst layer. And then knowing the current and the values for resistivity and the thickness of the GDL, we calculate the voltage loss per GDL as this value. The voltage loss through the bipolar plate. So usually you have seen that for all of them we are using the same formula, is the current, resistivity and the thickness of that field. And we calculate for all this, also for the contact resistance. So then we are able to calculate the total electric resistance, A as 0.01. Then based on that, we take into consideration the both sides. Voltage loss to the ionic resistance is calculated, and we calculate the total resistive losses. The fuel cell voltage corrected with the resistance will be 0.72, and the heat generation will be calculated at this value. Is something unclear here? Are you following this? Okay, five more minutes, yeah? So then we are able, based on this, to calculate the heat flux of the catalyst gas diffusion layer, taking into account the ionic resistance, and we obtain this value for the heat. The generation of the heat due to the resistance in the GDL is calculated as product between U and I. Heat generation due to the resistance in bipolar plate, heat generation contact resistance, heat flux in the bipolar plate cooling fluid interface, and in this way we are able to obtain the heat flux, also the Q1 and the Q2 by summing all the component elements that have been calculated.
Sorry, am I to stop you?
No.
Flux is always in relation with the second and the surface of the area. So here we can easily do things by flow.
Of course, yeah.
This is heat flow, not flux.
Yeah, yeah. But in principle here, well, we use this terminology just in order to make it very didactic. So going further, heat flux at the bipolar plate gas diffusion layer interface is calculated with Q3. And then we have the convection heat flux from the bipolar plate, which is calculated with the convective heat transfer formula. And the temperature is calculated as the temperature of the fluid plus the component that is coming from this convective transfer. We consider 1D model for heat transfer. So we take the Laplace equation with the internal sources of heat, and based on that we have the integration of this equation, and we obtain graphic of the temperature, and further on we need to calculate these two coefficients. For given conditions, there are calculated the coefficients C2 and C1, and we obtain the distribution of the temperature in the bipolar plate. So further on, using the effective value, we obtain the values for the different temperature that we fixed, for T2, for T3, and so on. And based on that, we obtain this distribution, where you could see that here we have the cooling channel, we have the bipolar plate, the GDL, and the catalyst layer. For this specific case, of course, due to the cooling channel, where we assume that we have convection, we shall have this evolution. Inside the bipolar plate, you have the temperature raise is not that big, and then we have the GDL area. So this is a simple approach when we would like to, further on, make details on this. Of course, we can take into consideration 2D models or 3D models for this, but this is just an example for you how to approach this element. What is the time now?
15 to 12.
So further on, we have to relate the aspects of heat transfer with water transfer, because coming back to the fuel cell and to the metaphora that was used by Dr. Jorissen is like a human body. So you know, also for the human body, we have the management of the temperature of the body based on the evaporation processes of the water. So also in the case of the fuel cell, the two elements of temperature or heat management and water management are coupled and are considered together. And the coupling between the water and let's say the heat transfer processes are connected to all elements of the processes, starting from the electrochemical processes through the transport processes and so on. So this is just a view graph to see how intimate the two processes of water release and heat release are connected. So from that perspective, when we have let's say advanced knowledge of heat release and the heat transfer processes, and from the other side on the water release and water transfer processes, then we could develop a sort of management approach to this. So generically, when we are talking about the two processes, I mean from one side the water management and from the other side the heat management, we have these two schemes. In the case of water management, we have to take into consideration the aspects related to humidification. Why we need humidification? Because we have seen that without humidifying our membrane is not working. Yeah? So it's clear that we have to humidify the inflow gases in order to humidify from both sides the membrane and to make it working. So this is clear aspect. Now the humidification is based on the partial pressure of water vapors into these gases. So you know that every gas, like is the case of air, is able to intake water vapors up to a certain partial pressure. So depending on the temperature of that specific gas, we can have a higher amount of water vapors into this specific gas, up to raising a specific pressure, which usually we call it the saturated partial pressure. So it's the pressure where or from where any kind of water vapors we are bringing into the mixture is condensated. So from that respect, we have this limit that usually is taking into account when we are humidifying the gas that we are trying to use. Okay, so what is the meaning of the partial pressure? Yeah, so when we are talking, usually we are using this word, partial pressure, partial, what means this? When we have a mixture, when we have a mixture, so we cannot discuss about partial pressure without having a mixture, okay? So we can talk about partial pressure only when we have at least two components in a gas. And partial pressure of a component is the pressure that the walls, the surroundings of that gas is pushing on that component. If that component would fill alone that volume, okay? So I have this room, and in this room the water vapor partial pressure is the pressure that the water vapors in the air of this room are going to act on the walls, or the walls are going to act on these vapors. If the water vapors would fill the entire volume alone without the other components. And this is a very important aspect that we have to take into our mind, because whenever we are dealing with these aspects, sometimes there are some, how can I say, tricky questions. Like the one from your quiz, for instance, where it's going to be, why you know very well that water is vaporizing at the room pressure, at the one atmosphere, is vaporizing at 100 degrees. But we know also that at the room temperature, like 25 degrees, we have water vapors. Why we have water vapors at room temperature in air mixture? Okay? What's the pressure? Okay, this is something with pressure, you know. You're right. So, everybody catch the question. So, usually when we are talking about water, we know that water is vaporizing at 100 degrees. Yeah? But, usually at the room temperature, we feel humidity and we have water vapors at 25 degrees. Why we have water vapors at 25 degrees?
Liquid water should be stay in equilibrium with its gases.
So, you know that usually when we are vaporizing water at a specific pressure, we have a specific temperature, TS, which is dependent of PS. So, for a specific pressure, we have a specific temperature. If we are raising the pressure, we shall have the vaporization at higher temperatures. If we are decreasing the pressure, we shall have the vaporization at lower temperature, isn't it? So you remember that it was discovery in the 19th century when they were going to Alps and they were trying to cook eggs. And they were not able to cook eggs. Why? Water was boiling at lower temperature and the eggs were not cooked. You have the same situation, the reverse situation in at home, in the kitchen, when you have a very old, how can I say, duck, and you want to boil it. So you have a pressurized vessel where for higher pressures you increase the temperature of boiling and you have a better and quicker cooking of that meat. So from that perspective, the vaporization temperature is connected to the pressure of that gas. In air, we have a mixture of, let's say, dry air plus water vapors. So we have the water vapors at lower pressure, at their partial pressure, partial vapor rate, okay? So from that perspective, we can have water as vapors, may even at the room temperature. Why? Because the pressure of the water vapors is much lower than the atmospheric pressure. Is this okay? So the same thing is happening also in the stream of hydrogen and oxygen, because we shall have the water vapors uptaken into the mixture at lower temperatures based on the partial vapor pressure of the water. Is clear this now for everybody? So from that perspective, based on this humidification processes on the fuel side and air side, we shall have a quantity of water vapors which are uptaken. And further on, we have in this process the water that is generated in the cathode side, and the water that is generated into the cathode side has to be managed in such a way that to not be too much here, in order to offer the possibility to transfer into the anode side and to keep the control of water. On the other side, for the heat, we have seen that there are many heat sinks and heat sources into this cell, and the heat transfer is done based on a cooling strategy. So we need to have some transporting carriers of heat. For having this, the first component for carriers are the two gases. So we have the hydrogen and we have air as initial carriers for such a heat. But we shall see that this is not enough. And when we are talking about larger fuel cells, we shall need additional cooling agent that has to bring, let's say, a support to the cooling of the cell itself. Please.
How is the heat profile that we are talking about stack going from one side to another side?
So you have seen in the previous or the other one was in table.
So in principle, we have this area with the highest release of heat. Okay, so we have the membrane area and we have the cathode catalyst region.
Now, imagine this one, I think can be measured now using this infrared kind of thermal camera.
Yeah, but infrared camera is measuring the external surface. So from that perspective, there are different attempts to develop, let's say, sections or semi-fuel cells that is emulating the conditions in order to get, let's say, the infrared view graphs of this. But also there are, please.
Using thermocouples, so there are tiny thermocouples that are introduced for this. Maybe Laurent, you
have all the for instance, some measurements in between plates, the small thermocouples inside, as you may have some current measurements, current density measurements.
So you measure them because the measurements on current are quite evaluated. So you can pinpoint the values of the current, and based on that, knowing the resistances, the local resistances, then you, convert this into the temperature. But also there are different other, activities to innovate and create in this area. And there are some attempts in some American universities trying to develop some sort of devices, very tiny devices, that could transmit their local temperature based on a change of color, for instance. or something else. So there are different attempts for this. Okay, so now coming back to to our subject, let us see a last problem. So this is also because you will receive all these presentations, and I wanted to put in the presentation also an example of how to calculate this kind of things, just in order to take it as an example how to make it. So we have also a fuel cell, hydrogen air, that might be cooled by evaporative cooling by injecting liquid water in the air inlet. So we have a system of injecting this and having the air flow rate sufficiently high. For a fuel cell that generates 1 kilowatt at 0.7 volts, find the required oxygen stoichiometric ratio and injected liquid water flow rate so that the outlet air is fully saturated at 65 degrees and there is no liquid water in the outlet, and that no additional cooling or heating of the fuel is required. Okay? So this is just a theoretical setup, just in order, because you could understand that practically we cannot make it. Usually we need to have also the humidification of hydrogen, and in any case we have heat losses. Air is supplied at room temperature with 70% relative humidity. Hydrogen is supplied in a dead-end mode, also it's a theoretical situation, at room temperature and dry. Assume that the net water transport through the membrane is sufficient to maintain saturated conditions in the anode chamber at 65 degrees. Inlet pressure is known, 120 kilopascal for both air and hydrogen. Our outlet pressure is atmospheric. So these are the known conditions. It is, once again, for everybody, it is, let's say, didactic, a theoretical situation where we have a fuel cell and we try to find out a possibility to not use an additional water heat management, mainly heat management system. We want to make everything just by injecting some water in the inlet of the air, and we have the hydrogen flux which is dry, and the water release is used also for humidification of the fuel cell. So usually here we are combining the two methods, mass balance and energy balance. We start from water balance with flows of water in air, water injected, the generated water, and on that way we are able to compute the flow of water in, air out, that the water is getting out with the flow of air. We take care of the utilization or the mole fraction of oxygen. We took care of the stoichiometric value of the oxygen and the flow of water. We took care of the values for humidity, relative humidity, and pressure, and based on that we calculate this value. The water generated is calculated based on this formula that was presented also yesterday. Is depending on the current and the molar mass of the gas. Then the water vapor in, air out, is calculated taking into account the same values, and based on this we obtain the water balance, which is of this formula, and by rearranging we have the flow of water injected, we have the stoichiometry of oxygen related into these values. So this was the part of the mass balance. Now we go with the energy balance, taking into account the inflows of energy with hydrogen, air, water, and injected water, and what we are getting out with the outflows. And based on that, we are calculating for each of these, we are calculating the flows of hydrogen, of air, and also for the air that is getting out of the fuel cell, and the water vapor in air out. So in such a way, it is possible to calculate the energy flows or the enthalpies for hydrogen that is in. Here we take the flow of hydrogen, we take the specific heat, the temperature, and the high heating value enthalpy. So based on these calculations, there are calculated the components of the energy balance. Then based on that, there are calculated also the water vapor in air, water injected, air out, and the water vapor in air that is getting out of the element. So with all this introduced in the formula, we are able to compute, knowing that the electricity generated is 1 kilowatt for this fuel cell, we can write the energy balance equation, where we have also two unknowns, which is the stoichiometry of oxygen and the flow rate of the injected water into the air. This equation, which is energy with the mass balance equations, are leading us to the final results for the two elements. So with the stoichiometry, which is theoretically reasonable, 4.24, and the quantity reasonable of water injected, theoretically it is possible to have a cell that could operate with dry fuel. In reality, as I mentioned, this is just a theoretical approach to this, because in reality, whenever we are talking about a system, we have to take into consideration very tiny but very important elements. So for the stack on the anode side, we need to take into consideration the humidification system, but also, due to the stoichiometry that was presented, we need to have the recycling loop of the fuel. On the cathode side, the same humidification, also the separation for the, of the water, and the reuse of the water for humidifiers. And further on, we need to have a system of cooling, which includes, as I mentioned, special, let's say, sections into the stack structure for, let's say, developing the cooling of the system.
Mostly air-cooled or water-cooled?
So everything depends. So you can have people saying, no, water cooling is the best. And there are many arguments saying, no, it's not the best. And there are also situations when you are dealing with air-cooled system. But depends also, and I'm sure that, Laurent, tomorrow you will say a few words about these aspects of operation. Because tomorrow there will be an extended discussion on operating conditions of this kind of fuels. So I have prepared the bowl for Laurent tomorrow. And he's going actually to extend these aspects, taking into account the influence of different factors into the operation conditions and so on. Okay, so now we have a few minutes for questions.
I have a question about this video here. And the recycling of the hydrogen, it's mixed with a water vapor, isn't it? Or water after it's coming out from the anode. How it's recycled and reused.
It looks complicated. It's looking complicated, but it's not complicated at all.
Okay.
So So first of all, you have to take into consideration that whenever you have a stream, doesn't matter if it's air or oxygen, the stream is taking as much water vapors as is needed, based on this pressure, partial pressure. So up to the moment of reaching the saturation point, so it's getting, and without whatever is more than this, is released, you know, this is very easy.
Okay.
So from that perspective, the recycling here is quite easy. The problem is down there.
What about the right side, the water coming out, why it's going back to the stack?
This is the cooling system.
Ah, okay. It's cooling.
This cooling system, you have a special type of coolant, which is there used for cooling. So I told you that the major problem we have here, because we have the loop for the air side, where we need to, let's say, separate the water. We need to have a system of trapping the water by condensing that. And this is not trivial.